be on it early on the side of TSM, because I think, and to the point about, you know, this being an engaged support meta, TSM is really going to look for SwordArt to prioritize having something that he can start fights on. So I agree. I think a Leona ban would have been, or sorry, a Thresh take ban and the Leona takeaway would have been more appropriate.
Well, that said, with the double AD carry bans, TSM does feel the need to reach for their marksman pretty early on with the Varus pick.
Yeah, they do, but I actually want to talk about the Gwen pick.
Yeah, please.
This is a pick that TSM has typically shied away from, and we've seen be higher priority for other teams, largely because I think when we think about TSM and their playstyle, they're more looking for who need to be on champions that are contributing to a team fight and less champions that need attention top lane. So I think that this is TSM saying is that, hey, we feel comfortable sort of leaving our comfort zone a little bit in this draft and playing something that we think is going to be a power pick. I personally really like this. And I also like the response of the Guardians to just pair Thresh with another hyper carry, right? Because he enables so much safety for a Jinx.
Yeah, I was going to say, speaking of the Thresh, I actually really like that lane.
And right, for much the same like reason that Aphelios is effective with it, right? Jinx gets covered in some of her, you know, lack of mobility by virtue of having a Thresh alongside her.
You do have a much weaker laning phase. Like, like Aphelios can fight back against Varus, right? Like, you've got the same range with green gun. Like, you've got the sustain out of red. Jinx is going to be a little bit on the back foot. Like, she's reasonably tanky, but, like, the sustain is not there. So, like, if Spica's landing a lot of stuff and it's sort of, like, ever lanes a single hook in lane, like, ooh, it's going to be tough for you. Sorry, buddy. But yeah, your late game is really, really incredible. Like, just having a just default 725 range, like, your team fighting is sick. One of the big things, actually, is being able to stay out of range of Gwen. Like, Gwen's, like, a team fighting is absurd, and, like, she's just, like, the best late game top laner.
Yeah.
I think right now in Pro League of Legends. And there's a good chance Stixxay can actually be out of that range and, like, not get pinned down and still team fight well. And right, if the front lines are there, can actually just do more than lost in the team fights, even with a Gwen trying to chase her down.
Second round of bans coming out now. We got the LeBlanc on one side, the Olaf on the other. You know, going back to your point about draft, Emily, obviously they don't have the AP threat in the jungle for Golden Guardians, so you assume it will be coming from the mid lane again at this point. Where does Golden Guardians go to kind of round out their composition with the way that they've built it so far?
Yeah, I mean, I think I am really curious to see what they're going to do with the mid lane pick. I'm also curious to see if TSM are going to flex that Gwen into the jungle, possibly. Removing the Renekton is really good, in my opinion, just because he has such an early lane prowess. I'm also wondering, because another ban strategy we've seen against TSM is to take away those scaling mid lane picks that PoE really, really loves to play. And hey, they're all available, right?
Like, right,
the Victor is available,
there.
The Azir is available.
Yeah.
So I'm especially curious to see what TSM actually end up taking in the mid lane, because right now I like, you know, you have Varus for the poke damage, you have Gwen who's just insanely, insanely strong in late game team fights. Up, and we're getting Nocturne.
Please be jungle Nocturne. Please, TSM. You didn't pick it yesterday. You let it go through. I think jungle Nocturne, by the way, is still amazing.
Yeah.
I will say, I think Nocturne is very, very good against low mobility champions. Obviously, Thresh can Lantern a Jinx away, but you can still go Stridebreaker. Mm-hmm. You jump on her with a Stridebreaker, she's not getting away from you. Like, if there's no Lantern, that girl is dead. If you're holding a ward in time, you block Lantern, like, that girl is dead if you have any follow-up, and Gwen will be there. So I am a fan of Gwen top Nocturne jungle, and you just kill backline.
Yeah. Having seen, now that we see the Gwen and the Nocturne and the Complex, it looks like TSM is actually playing a more aggressive draft than we typically expect.
I will be
expect.
Very surprised.
So what I want to see Golden Guardians just go hard on the defense, actually. If you're going to be playing around a Jinx, like, you don't want to be playing another
champion. All right. Okay. I was going to be like, sorry, Kaizen, I was just looking and I was like, the
what
Trundle.
What does Trundle do?
Yeah, I was like,
this is not a Trundle game.
I was like, okay, in a world where you're all AD, I guess you have Tank Shred with the Trundle Ultimate. You're going to get to one person. Like, try it. No,
it's
no.
It's a troll hover.
It went very much. Okay.
Yeah, my days are limited.
In general, especially if they do end up picking the Ryze, I like TSM's ability to collapse and then also be able to scrap with the Gwen.
On the other side, I actually really like...
It also scales very well.
Sorry, go ahead. What were you saying again?
Oh, no, I was saying the Ryze scales really well.
It does. I think this is a TSM draft that is not their strong suit, but I think this is a game where they're looking to experiment pretty clearly. I think the moment we saw the Gwen, we should expect, okay, TSM is just trying to, you know, develop more styles in the arsenal. So I would say that the Golden Guardians draft is much more straightforward to play through. They have a huge front line in Sett, Volibear, and even Sylas to an extent is sort of like he can be built, you know, somewhat tanky. And I think it's just a straight front back-to-back team fight, actually, which is ironically what you normally associate with TSM. Yep. Whereas with TSM, you're more looking for 1-3-1. You're more looking for Gwen to be supporting the Nocturne and the Ryze as they make side lane plays.
All right, well, we're past the 20-second mark on the countdown.
We're not,
So because of this, I now favor Golden Guardians. Because I think, because if it was the other way around, I think Huni wins side lane late game and you've eventually got other priority. I think Golden Guardians have a winning top lane. I think the mid should be fine. It's going to be more TSM pressure early game, which will make it a little bit harder for Volibear to get ganks off. But I like the team fed a lot more because Gwen won't be fed enough to kill the Jinx.
A quick reminder to those of you at home, as Champion Select is over, this is the time in the remote world where we have to build a 3-minute delay for competitive integrity. And so you will be with us during that 3 minutes. And then when the game is ready to go, we'll toss you out to the arena for the casters to make the call. But I want to continue this conversation around expectation within the game. You know, the fact that with a Gwen in the side lane, you might expect Huni to get the better of the 1v1 in the late game. Not the case. He is one of those players that is really held fast to the Nocturne in the top lane, even following a few of those hits. And so I'm not sure how much of that I want to pin to, you know, because he's generally such a creative player. He's so willing to move on to new things. Why is it that he's holding fast to the Nocturne? Why is it that TSM finds so much value in this pick?
Well, I think it's a pick that allows them to have pressure, you know, in the early game where otherwise as a team, they generally don't, right? When you think about TSM's bot lane, it's not characterized by being super lane dominant. They have their moments, but it's more about unlocking SwordArt to roam. When you think about their mid lane, it's generally playing more controlled, looking to scale to mid and late game. So top lane is actually usually where the pressure comes from. And, you know, they've done fine on the Nocturne. They beat Immortals with this pick as well. Mm-hmm. So I think it's okay for them to continue to pick the Nocturne. It's something that they're comfortable with while they're experimenting with these other picks. I'm actually looking on the Golden Guardian side, though. Like, this is a team that typically has had Licorice on picks that can split push and more create individual pressure. And this is a more team-oriented pick. I think both teams are slightly out of their comfort zone, but I think to Freak's point, the Golden Guardians draft is way more straightforward to play, but I think TSM is the better team.
Yeah. Well, and this is like an iteration of TSM's draft against FlyQuest, which is a game that, you know, you can argue they had that kind of shaky reset that FlyQuest then capitalized on in the top lane and ended up winning the game after that team fight and it turned around. But TSM had really strong control of that game with the Nocturne into the Aurelia matchup. Not really sure it was supposed to go that way, but and then PoE in the jungle also with the Ryze. And then they had Diana. So, I mean, I think this is, I guess, TSM kind of shifting or like iterating on something that they've tried out before. And then even though it did lose that game, it came down to like that kind of single play. It wasn't necessarily the draft itself.
Yeah. Totally agree. Yeah, it's clear that they're iterating, and I personally love it, right? Like, we're in week 8. It would be very easy to say, hey, let's just double down on what we're strong on, but I think TSM, they're aiming high for themselves, right? Yeah. And they recognize that in a best of 5, you want to have at least the threat of multiple looks. You want to be able to show that, hey, we will take the Gwen occasionally when it's available, and I think that was a gap in their style. So even if today doesn't show that, hey, all of a sudden they're really good at playing 1-3-1, it will put the fear of these power picks that are in the meta in the minds of other teams.
Yeah, I mean, Huni wants to play early aggressive champions, right? And if you look at Gwen, like, she's like really good at level 1, but like she's gonna power trough like around level 5. She's gonna kind of taper off through like a lot of the sort of like the early mid game and laning phase. Then she catches back up, and then it's amazing. Right now, Huni just wants to play early aggressive stuff. So like when we watch his Nocturne, like he's the only player to have won with Nocturne top on this patch. He's the only one. Mm-hmm. Like 5 players have played it. He's the only one who's actually won on it.
Right.
I don't think it's still very good. But like he's getting consistent early pressure with it. Like he's gotten like level 2 solo kills. So like that part is working. I think it's not a well-rounded top lane anymore. And again, not a good one. But if it's the exact style Huni wants to play, he wants to be lane dominant. He wants to get that done. It's why we saw the set, because we thought it was a Gwen counterpick. And, you know, here we are.
Right, yeah. It's hard to argue with success.
Yeah.
Even if we might not
he's 1-2. To be clear, he's 1-2.
We can argue
with not exactly successful.
We can argue with mixed success.
Mixed success. You can't argue with mixed success. Let's talk real briefly about lane priority, because you already mentioned Jinx. Yeah. Perhaps a weaker laner than you would expect the Aphelios to be, but you at least have pseudo range support against the Nautilus. You know, where do we expect both teams to have pressure on the map?
So I expect bot lane pressure on the TSM side. I expect top lane pressure on TSM side. I don't know what Sylas versus Ryze looks like. So my guess is TSM has more early prio. However, the jungler from Golden Guardians has more early pressure.
All right, well, those are our thoughts ahead of game number 1. Golden Guardians TSM out to PastryTime and Azael for the call.
Hello, hello. Thank you very much, Dash and friends. This is going to be a fun one. We're getting close to playoffs, Azael. Not quite there yet. Week 8, day number 2, as the Golden Guardians look to try and squeak in to the final playoffs. What nice dodge from AblazeOlive gets out from under the hook of SwordArt, as TSM did try a late-ish invade. Not that late.
Yep. Once again, showing why you do not skill before you see someone. Mm-hmm. Saving that, skills up to E, easy dodge away. Nicely done there by AblazeOlive. I'm going to be interested to see how this does play out, because like Free said, you know, there are some pushing lanes on the TSM side, but when you have pushing lanes and you have a losing jungle, there is some danger there, because to win these matchups, you generally want to push in, you want to harass, you want to constantly be shoving, and that does expose you to Volibear. It's going to be somewhat up to the laners, somewhat up to Spica to actually be tracking where Iconic is, because Volibear is a very dangerous early game jungler, especially with PTA. Those ganks can be pretty fearsome.
And of course, for all our Spanish-speaking friends, the team over at FlyQuest is putting on an all-Spanish broadcast over at twitch.com/FlyQuest. So go ahead and check that out. I'll have both on. And I don't know. If you speak both languages, let us know how we're casting different. That'd be kind of cool. I want to know what they're saying that I'm not saying.
I feel like if you were listening to both at the same time, you couldn't really listen to either.
Yeah, that's true. So that'd be very challenging.
Just put on the audio-only one as well. You know, all three simultaneously.
Ooh. I mean, you say it like it's be crazy, but I don't know.
You're like, oh, there might be something there.
You know what? It's just an embarrassment of our ways to listen/watch the League of Legends.
True.
A great thing here. As Huni is at it again. The old Nocturne.
Yeah.
Still here in the 1v1 up against Licorice's set.
It is interesting. It just seems to be more of a Huni thing than a meta thing.
A lot of TSM things.
Yeah. Lost. Nice little sidestep there on the hook. And Nocturne is going to be able to push. The spell shield is very effective against the Haymaker from Sett. You can always kind of save that because that is the biggest point of return damage there coming out. It's pretty easy to spell shield. Probably doesn't even have it skilled right now, so yeah. They're not really making it a lot.
I hope he can spell shield it when he has it. Because, oh boy.
If you cannot react to that, you've got bigger problems than your champion pick.
Nice hook there. Oh, Sodat actually going to have to flash Chime. Really nice amount of pressure there with the Thresh. So Sodat down a summoner. Of note, it is Ignite and Cleanse. Mm-hmm. The other two there for Lost and Sawdust. So a bit more defensive on the TSM side as topside is going to get aggressive. Licorice in trouble.
Looks like they want to try to set up for a dive here. They have the stacked wave. Oh. Spica's coming as well, so this could be a three-man dive.
Done, already burnt. Licorice going to have trouble getting out of here. He does have the flash. Going to have to chill TP in. There's the W. Huni does spell shield it, but the damage from the tower is a little too much. Spica already is going to get picked off of the AblazeOlive. Gets first blood, and now PowerOfEvil perhaps on the menu does flash away.
That one wasn't even close.
Oh,
no!
Flash done. Conqueror proc to AblazeOlive is really getting in there. Level 4 Sylas trying to make it happen. Little ambitious, but I like it. Very stylish.
Yeah, TP's up at the top side, collects double buffs there. He's probably just going to push in this wave here with Licorice, then reset. You can see that Iconic on the minimap is actually covering his roam. This is something that you always love to see at the pro level. Junglers, take note. When your solo laner moves to another solo lane to cover, when your top laner TB's bot, anything like that, push out their wave, reset that for them. Now that mid wave will be bouncing back. It also forces out PowerOfEvil's TP as a response to collect that wave. So Iconic, you know, making a smart play here, and this makes up for the TP that had to be used up to top side. And TSM just seemed very hesitant to go for this. I mean, they kind of went in fairly early, then Spica arrives. They're not really starting it up, and I'm kind of wanting to track, does the Ryze damage actually land? And it does, but the Haymaker shield is just so much there. Spica gets taken down. There's still a good 200, 300 health left on Licorice, so they weren't particularly close to actually making that dive happen. That felt more like a situation where you should try to get the TP and probably just immediately back off instead of committing to the dive. And it did seem like Huni was backing up pretty quickly. So maybe a little bit of spit comms, maybe a little bit of overestimating their damage, but pretty rough play for them there as they're not able to deny the wave. First blood over to AblazeOlive, and he's going to have a nice time in mid lane now as a result with the double buffs.
Yeah, even though down a wave CS right now should be just fine as the wave pushes on, especially if you can find more timings like that. I mean, that one was with the TP, I suppose, so made quite a bit easier, but still getting aggressive. Sorta in the back, but PowerOfEvil just almost dead in the 1v1. Sorta going to have to come in to help push the wave alongside Spica.
Yeah, and this is something we actually were talking about right before the cast started, is how it can get rough for Ryze if you do fall behind early. Iconic, though.
3v3 Sorta here, but Iconic going in, just taking out PowerOfEvil. Such a good play out of the Golden Guardians. Jungle, the Flay's going to connect onto Sorta, and Iconic grabs a well-deserved double kill.
Really nicely done. The Ryze was going to be in trouble against AblazeOlive. He was behind here. He didn't have a strong early buy. As a result, TSM moved members mid to try to help him reset the wave, to try to cover him here. But Golden Guardians have stronger members, so they just show up too. They get the kills. Iconic, strong early game jungle here. Gwen not going to have much threat in these early levels. And Iconic, as a result, gets two kills. They get the dragon. AblazeOlive is feeling great. And still, PowerOfEvil, without much of a buy here, is going to be in danger because there's still no flash available here for the next couple minutes on this Ryze.
And now a dragon goes over to Golden Guardians. It is just all good right now. Every single lane is feeling it. Stixxay is pushing in. He's got even farm and feels pretty good on the jig. So watch this one again. This is just such a good counter gank by Golden Guardians.
Yeah, absolutely. The initial trade was great there. PowerOfEvil gets put low. Spica's here to cover. SwordArt is here. But the match comes in from Golden Guardians. You can see on the minimap, it's a wraparound from the top side. It's Chime collapsing from the bot side. Despite this nice hook from SwordArt onto AblazeOlive, it doesn't matter because Chime is there to follow up, and the Volibear has more than enough damage. The CC chain is there. Volibear stun into the hook coming through from Chime. Double kill early on for Iconic, and that's going to put Gwen, who is already a weak early game jungler, in an even rougher spot because when you're actually comparing the buys, oh, they're looking for another repeat.
The flash hook.
He's back, yeah.
Produces, looks, expects the dodge down. Instead, PowerOfEvil just walks comfortably back towards the tower, but again, this is the pressure you want to see from Chime. This is the early game you want out of, you know, a first pick Volibear and a support like Thresh.
Absolutely. You know, and I love the rinse and repeat, right? It is a basic thing, but it's something that you have to work into your game. You have to make time for, make sure you're not losing too much on the other side of the map. Jinx is going to maybe give up a couple CS, but the wave wasn't in too bad of a spot. Chime is back here to actually cover, so it's mostly getting picked up.
Ulti out of Lost, actually. That's what snags Chime, but not that much follow-up damage. Hook's not going to connect, but Spica is the big threat alongside PoE. Realm Warp's looking good. 2v4 right now for Golden Guardians. As Chime going to try and make it happen. Gets the play Aftershock proc, but not enough to save him from Lost. To Stixxay blasting away at SwordArt, trying to get a kill. Looking for the counter. W does not connect onto the Nautilus, and Lost will collect the double kill.
Ah, that's a huge punish there from TSM. So critical that they get that. Even with the double kill, they're down a little bit on gold, but that was such a big move to the bot side. This is gonna be two waves fully denied. Lost gets both the kills, so puts them in a big advantage now over the Jinx. And once that Realm Warp comes in behind, once they are already between you and your path of retreat, there's not really any way out in that 2v4. There was no teleports actually available on the Golden Guardian side, so good summoner tracking there from TSM. Volibear's not there, and it's just a really nice move here from PowerOfEvil and Spica down to that bot side.
Yeah, definitely makes up for the level 3 dive in top lane, right? Much better execution. They're in bottom side to TSM, kind of right the ship, get the gold back to about 600 between them. Golden Guardians still ahead, both that gold and the dragon they picked up, but that was, bottom lane was the only one that wasn't, you know, starting to get an advantage for Golden Guardians. I was expecting Iconic and AblazeOlive to pay it forward and go down there, but TSM get the first jump and do manage to give Lost actually a very early mana Mune as well.
Yeah, and that's going to feel really nice, and putting this Varus actually ahead of the Jinx is going to make things a lot more difficult for Stixxay to keep that farm up. You know, generally, Jinx is more the late-game insurance here, wants to be kind of farming, wants to be comfortable picking up as much of that as possible, getting as much gold in her pockets as possible. And you have these kind of bruiser squad up on the top side that's supposed to be the ones scrapping there, supposed to be the ones creating space. But if Stixxay falls too far behind Lost in this bot side, it can be difficult for him to really keep pace.
All right, well, a little late there for Speaker's War, but does at least get the info. Probably wasn't going to be able to contest anyway. So Rift Herald does go over to Golden Guardians as a result, but the gold is even as the dust settles. TP in though, insta flash from Chime, puts up the box. Lost is the target, trying to pick up the Varus. The ulti will connect, as now the stolen ulti out of AblazeOlive is going to knock up SwordArt, and that should be a kill. Stixxay going to be the one to grab the double this time.
Man, this game is hype. Both teams are being so proactive back and forth. This time, AblazeOlive knows he has his TP first because he made the earlier TP to the top side. They forced out the TP from PowerOfEvil back to mid lane. Remember, that was Iconic shoving out mid lane, forcing out PowerOfEvil's TP. So they have this slight TP advantage there. They pull the trigger on this play here, and this is just really nicely done. Back up onto the top side, gonna see what happened here. Flash, dunk, Huni back. He pops the ulti, but just no way out. So another kill up on the top side, and things looking really nice for Golden Guardians off the back of a couple of really aggressive plays. And both mid laners have been very proactive at getting out of their lanes.
This is great. I love seeing both these teams just staying proactive, playing for the side lanes. I mean, you pick Ryze and Sylas to be active in the mid game, right? You definitely don't pick Sylas, especially, to sit around and farm mid lane and hope that the late game comes and things are feeling all good. So Huni going to start to get aggressive again, but does have his flash up, doesn't have his ult, but probably not going to be relevant for any sort of defense, as Licorice maybe going to ask for a revisit here in top lane.
Yeah, and right now we'll see if Licorice is going to actually turn around to shove this, but it did look like it was coming towards him. He's already up a bit on farm, so it is going to be difficult for Huni to really scrap with that set, especially if he does get out to an early advantage. Tabby's going to be super effective for him. And you can also see Iconic already has the Divine Sunderer completed, first Mythic in the game. He is going to be such a threat. Could really outduel anyone on TSM right now, so they're going to have to play very carefully around where this Volibear could be.
And aware that Speaker's cleared the Scuttle Crab here in the bottom river, so now they're actually going to roam back around to the bottom side of the map. Stixxay, though, is going to play respectfully back, needs to watch the Ryze. We know PowerOfEvil is right left of his blue buff, but Iconic is already down here trying to track some of that, because I do believe Golden Guardians want to force a fight at this dragon. As Speaker gets himself clipped, trying with the flame, but not enough to follow through, is there's only one Golden Guardians member that can go over that wall right now, and it's Chime.
Yeah, that definitely would have been an inch if they went over. I mean, maybe a Lantern Iconic in, but even so, the TSM bot lane could have had first move. Small thing, but funnily enough, I think it actually would have been better for Iconic just throw his E onto the dragon there instead of trying to aim for Spica. Just aggro the dragon, get that to do a little bit of damage to Spica on the exit, but Golden Guardians trying to set up for this. Notice that Stixxay is still pretty far away, so I don't think they actually want to hard commit to this. TP advantage ever so slightly in favor of Huni. Licorice is about to come up, and it will, as a result, just be TSM's dragon there. You know, Stixxay was kind of cut off. Licorice was a couple seconds late on having that teleport available. So both teams grabbing a dragon, and Mountain Dragon going to be the name of the game here, which should be a very powerful one in this matchup.
It's a nice delayed trade there for Golden Guardians. Going to get a plate, and then the Rift Herald's going to grab probably two more as the charge does come through. So 1.5 left on that here, 1.5 minutes to clear those out, but still some good gold. I mean, that was kind of your expected trade anyway, but Golden Guardians at least give themselves the option of contesting the dragon, but don't overextend and still manage to grab the gold they were trying to get as well.
Yeah, and I think in most cases, you just want them to fully give it up if you're not going to go for it. I think it's okay to kind of poke and prod if you have Thresh, because you can set things up where Volibear maybe alts in, tries to smite it if the situation is there, you get lanterned out. So like that's more acceptable if you have that read that you can maybe make a play happen there. Oh, Nocturne ulti coming. PowerOfEvil's here.
3v3 now as AblazeOlive's in there. Sett, oh my goodness, the dunk is big. Looking for the pullback, finds two Iconic. Gets right in there, dunks on him as Realm Warp is going to get popped, but it will not save PowerOfEvil, and the dive may not be done yet for Golden Guardians.
Oh, they're trying to wrap around behind him here. AblazeOlive can stop with the Gwen ulti. He can actually hit them here, and it's going to get stopped by Iconic just with the E, so they're trying to set this up. You can see SwordArt is actually racing out of base, but will he be here in time? He's pretty far away.
Wave's coming in. All right, who's going to tank it? Licorice no ulti, but still is the W. He's going to go in first, finds a facebreaker, flashback there. Ulti out of Sylas there, as Licorice is just still taking the tower. They're going for it all. AblazeOlive low, but Iconic will get the last kill, and PowerOfEvil is maybe going to be too late, but SwordArt does arrive in time to give one back. It's PowerOfEvil that finds the shutdown.
They get one back, but they lost a lot on that top side. The 3v3 skirmish going so heavily in the favor of Golden Guardians. This Volibear is ridiculously strong. Sett is ahead. Sylas is ahead. All three members that were in that 3v3 were stronger than their counterparts. So Golden Guardians executing on it well. Licorice setting it up. Iconic following through here. They look for the play, but the roam was very quick from Sylas, and this is where you can see, all right, let's go. They go straight in. PowerOfEvil actually flashed over the wall to avoid the chain stun coming through there from AblazeOlive, but he just lands into Licorice, and it's Volibear from the top rope there, jumping in to slam that first kill home. They delay the recalls. They go right in. Licorice tanking it up for quite a few tower shots. And I mean, they're just so healthy that they can make this dive happen even in the extended play. Yes, AblazeOlive does end up going down, but it's flash from SwordArt, it's TP from PowerOfEvil. They got three kills in the extended play, and TSM only gets one back while spending more summoners.
Yeah, well worth it there for Golden Guardians, as they will be up 3,500 gold as the Golden Guardians supporters are out in force on Twitter today. Definitely not how I thought this game was gonna start off, but Golden Guardians, credit to them. They've been improving week on week. I feel like they've been finding their footing both around objectives, which was one of my big criticisms of them earlier on in the split. They've cleaned a lot of that up.
Yeah.
And their early game has kind of only gotten smoother and faster.
I mean, honestly, they've really impressed me. You know, there was that initial kind of surge when Licorice joined the team, and it's like, okay, well, when's the other shoe going to drop? Are they going to turn back into a pumpkin? It's just 1 week. All right, well, it's just 2 weeks. All right, now we're in the third week, and it's like, well, they're actually still just good. So they're playing very, very well over the last couple of weeks. Ever since Licorice has joined them, it's been kind of 2-1 week, 2-1 week, and they're looking for another one here. We'll see if they can get this win over TSM. Out to a very strong early lead. TSM does have strong scaling, though. The ability to side lane, especially late game, you know, with this Ryze is going to be critical when you're pairing that up with someone like a Nocturne who can shadow you. If someone from Golden Guardians shows up, that 1v1 becomes a 2v1, and maybe you can make something happen there. So it's going to be up to Golden Guardians to really try to snowball this game, because they were in a good position yesterday and weren't able to really close out what was a game that they were playing very well in the early stages.
Yeah, definitely a rough one there up against CLG SA, but credit to CLG for picking up the win. We'll see if TSM can hold on in a similar way. They are going to, as always, be trusting in their scaling. Golden Guardians do have some insurance in the form of Stixxay, but it's definitely not endless when you're playing this kind of Ryze especially. Of note, Golden Guardians did get the mid-outer as well. That actually happened in the replay we had near the top side. They're actually up in that first tower gold as well. That's kind of beefing up their gold leaders. Everfrost doesn't quite connect there. Now a 3v4 as the AblazeOlive is going to get blown up, and TSM, this time they're the ones with the counterplayers. That ulti is not going to save Iconic.
Oh, it's the whole squad there. AblazeOlive knew he had two members behind him. PowerOfEvil was like, oh, you got two? That's cute. I brought the whole team, baby. TSM piles in. They get the kills there. They're going to take the dragon off the back of this. And that gold lead gets smaller. They take the neutral objective lead. That is smart stuff here. TSM with the correct read. They know that they want to try to punish this Ryze. His flash is down. He's in the side lane. Easy target. Well, not if you have three members behind you.
Right, and the problem is that nothing else was happening on the map for Golden Guardians for them to try and punish them overloading the bottom side of the map, right? Huni is just in top side and lane's not pushing. Stixxay hasn't gotten mid push any further up, so Golden Guardians can maybe set the map up a little bit more neatly next time, but I do like the spirit of the play, and honestly, just credit to TSM for finding maybe the obvious play, but definitely the right counterplay to make for them.
I mean, it's just a really good read, right? And in some of these previous plays, they've maybe been a touch late to actually arrive to that play to try to turn things around. On this one, they were there right on time. AblazeOlive had his team members behind him, but, you know, you go in, they're not right there with you, so he was dead before anything could really happen. After that play, he picks up the stopwatch, so maybe had he had that prior, he could have delayed, bought enough time, maybe make something from that. But TSM into a good spot here. We can see Golden Guardians, though, four strong on this bot side. They want to take down this outer tower. TSM anticipating the play on the top side. I mean, just look at how they're playing, right? It's where is Ryze? All right, stand behind him.
Yep. You know,
these guys are basically just going to play in whatever lane PowerOfEvil is in. They want to enable him to get farm. They want to make sure he's staying safe. He's getting to a really strong part of the game, and you have to do that for Ryze. And so as soon as Golden Guardians show bot, they will get out of there. They will look to defend this tier 2 bot. Try to stop the second charge of the Herald.
Not going to stop the charge, but I don't think the follow-up siege will be there. Big amount of damage. Dick's actually trying. Huni will spell shield an incoming Thresh hook, but Herald will die, and Golden Guardians maybe going to try for one more wave. They might have enough here to push through, and indeed they will. Chain of Corruption won't stop them. Lights are out there. Huni charging through the mid lane. Who is it he's trying to pick off? It is indeed Licorice, but that is not a particularly easy target to take out.
No, he's way too tanky. Not going to be able to take him down. PowerOfEvil, though, is taking down the tier 1 tower top. But still, it is isolated golem PoE. That is nice, but you gave up the tier 1 and the tier 2. Also expended the Nocturne ulti there, which is still a fairly long cooldown. PowerOfEvil trying to continue to push, but Golden Guardians will be back to base in time to defend their tier 2 tower. A nice little push there from them, and recognizing that they have got to have their members behind their split pusher, behind AblazeOlive, who's out there in that side lane, and make sure that TSM cannot just overrun them with numbers.
All right, well, pretty big shopping trips there for Golden Guardians. Stixxay with the Runan's finish. Zhonya's now done for Iconic. It has become a standard on Volibear, and Aegis as well, done for Chime. So already Mythic's completed everywhere, and now second item starting to be worked in as well. In fact, Zhonya's also done for AblazeOlive just now. So Golden Guardians definitely fight ready. Nothing to fight for just yet, with the Dragon coming up in 2 minutes and Baron being a little too early, but we do want to see them stay proactive here.
Absolutely, and I think they're gonna have to try to fight around jungle camps. If you want to try to force something, you can't just wait for soul. The fact that TSM got two of these early dragons just pushes your soul back way too late in the game. That's not what they should be looking for. So we see them now moving in. They're trying to take over the enemy jungle. You get vision. You try to kind of set up this line of vision along this area, but TSM are looking to contest. Here comes Spica.
Well, the Guardians might have enough. Licorice in the top lane. It's PowerOfEvil all the way bot side, but he does have teleport. So he's going to be trying to play the side lane for as long as he can and hoover up all the farm. But Golden Guardian's actually just looking straight for the siege here. TSM going to have to defend 4v3. And I don't know if that's going to really happen. Lost moving in. Lights are out. That's Licorice going to be on top of the lantern, but he can't quite grab it. And off to the other side, it's Spica going to take out Licorice. It's iconic. Forced to ult away. And PowerOfEvil does join it. Yeah, they are going to go for it. Everyone in the pool! And now Stixxay are going to be forced to flash away. TSM ripping through the rest of Golden Guardians, and Stixxay is untouched, but he can't shoot back either. It's TSM finding four kills.
That could be Baron, Pastry, TSM come up huge. Golden Guardians thought they could go for the wraparound dive, force out the teleport, and then back off. But TSM just didn't let him. Licorice could not click on the lantern. Iconic couldn't get away. The Realm Warp comes through. All five TSM members stack on top of him. They take him down. They'll get the Baron. They're even waiting for a Sword Art insult to injury. TSM back in control of this game.
Alrighty, well, look, watch the flip the switch rocket replay, because my goodness, TSM turned this one around.
Yeah, no kidding. The stopwatch there was big. Then they're saying, all right, no problem. Retreat here. But Sword Art lands the hook. The immediate lantern, look at that. It took 2 points of damage. That is Licorice trying to click on that. That pink ward blocking the lantern completely. In those situations, you've actually got to zoom in your camera to try to get an alternate angle to sometimes allow you to click on it. But that's difficult to do in a high pressure situation really, really quickly. So the teleport comes through. They get the initial kill. And then just piling in on top of your opponents. You have the Realm Warp to chase them down. TSM now on the map with the Baron buff here, looking for the third dragon. Golden Guardians want to contest, but TSM are strong now.
Yeah, you can say that again. 10 stacks for two different Magi's, I think I saw. Huni is diving in. Golden Guardian trying to kite back. AblazeOlive with the flank. Does have the stolen Nautilus ulti. Chime finds a hook. AblazeOlive going in there. Iconic looking for the counter gank. Now Zonyas has popped off, but Spica is the one for target with the stolen Nautilus ulti. Now Huni going to take out Iconic. Gwen going to rip through one more as Licorice does find a kill back. But PowerOfEvil puts an end to all that, making a double for Spica as that's four dead once again. And Chime is the only one left, but not for very long. Back to base you go to join the rest of your team as another Bud Light Ace is completed for TSM.
TSM are stacking up the Magi's as well. 20 pages in Spica and PowerOfEvil. They are huge now. They were trying to fight past this front line into the back line, take down this Varus. But when you're ignoring the Gwen, when you're ignoring the Ryze, and they are this strong, that is so dangerous to do. TSM running over Golden Guardians at this point. They had a great early game, but cannot contest TSM in this mid game, in this late game. TSM getting multiple tier 2 towers off the back of that as well. The gold lead is exploding. You can see the Red Bull Baron buff there. Plus 6,000 gold. Here it is one more time. There's no summoners available onto Stixxay, so they just push him back. Golden Guardians wants to try to engage with AblazeOlive here, as well as Chime and Iconic. Iconic diving to the backline, but he's basically dead on arrival. He's already down to 15% just from the damage he took in the air. And then trying to fight into this backline here, Spica just sectioning off multiple members, taking them down. The sustain is so incredibly high, and PowerOfEvil was untouched pretty much through that entire fight. He is just free-firing this mid-jungle for TSM, just roasting up Golden Guardians, and now the pushes are just continuing. They're getting even more.
Yeah, I know Coach Bjergsen's like a pretty big fan of reading, actually. Makes sense. TSM Book Club looking pretty good with 20 stacks apiece there between Speaker and PoE. And now Golden Guardians gonna have to fight through a pretty impossible feeling situation. Tier 2 in mid's gonna fall. Call it six towers now for TSM. And sure, the Baron's worn off, but TSM will be back for more. They're even on track for that soul in 3 minutes and 40 seconds.
Yeah, they are looking really good. The only hope for Golden Guardians kind of at this point is trying to take down PoE, trying to take down Spica. If you get a couple of big shutdowns, take some of those Magi stacks off. That is a big swing of gold, not only in the influx of gold that you're getting for the shutdowns, but also the removal of power by taking those Magi stacks away. We'll see if they're going to be able to do it, though. It will be difficult. because the Zonias is available for Spica, the stopwatch is available for PoE. They have those defensive luxury items at this point, and they are pressing.
All right, well, Golden Guardians definitely had a lot of good looks in the early game. I think trying to open up the mid-game more is where TSM really put an end to the snowball that was happening, and now definitely getting snowballed on. So we'll see how Golden Guardians' defense looks here. Going to have to answer the question of who's going to grab the Dragon Soul in 2 minutes and 50 seconds, but still have time to set that up as Sorta is going to try and get the requisite vision down.
Yeah, looking to get there early, start fighting around that vision. And also just again, wherever Power of Evil is, someone from TSM kind of needs to be shadowing him because you're playing against a Nocturne team. So, you know, or rather, you're playing with the Nocturne. You want to be able to cover your side lanes. You want to be able to set up these sorts of plays where Power of Evil can push freely, where Nocturne can push freely, and then move and collapse. And a lot of that is about getting vision, is about kind of shadowing your laners as they try to press up aggressively and really make the most of their leads.
Gunna gonna take the Lantern out to safety, but TSM is just pushing Golden Guardians back towards basically only their third of the map. Chime is gonna try and get some vision back here. But doesn't find any wards with the sweeper, looks for the hook, Spica dashes away, and is trying to get, you know, a little bit of vision snuck around some corner so they can maybe find out when TSM next assault the Baron, because Golden Guardian's gonna really struggle to just get out to the objectives that TSM are looking to line up in the next 2 minutes.
Yeah, absolutely. It does get very difficult. At this point, you really are kind of hoping for some sort of a fantastic engage, a really good flank from Licorice to maybe, you know, dunk in Power of Evil or something like that. But that is why TSM is trying to be so diligent with their warding. You know, you look at the minimap here, the deepest line of vision for TSM is really this, right? It's those couple wards. They have no flanking wards available. That is why we are seeing Golden Guardians move forward with the sweepers, excuse me, TSM trying to sweep out the Golden Guardians' vision. You know, moving forward with those sweepers, trying to deny any chance of a TP flank from Licorice, from AblazeOlive. Because if you don't allow them to get in the back line and you're playing with this sort of a lead, it becomes really, really difficult for your opponents to really be able to get anything done.
All right, well, just patience now. Golden Guardians, though, counter-pushing mid. Trying to get some pressure back again. You have to push this to gain access to this river. And Golden Guardians need to take some of this real estate back as Spica. I say Corp, but not really, because he's got his teammates behind him.
He's just running at them.
Yeah.
I mean, they don't know where everyone
exactly.
else is. He does have two members behind him, and I guess the Nocturne could collapse, so theoretically could turn into a 4v4. Plus, you have the little mist zone to deny any sort of a hook coming through. Power of Evil is pushing on the bot side. He's got his TP available. And you can see he's getting more and more comfortable. Now has the death cap completed
with that,
plus the Mage Eyes. He is going to be huge. You land one combo, really. 852 AP at this point in the game now for Power of Evil. That's like one combo on Jinx, practically.
Yeah. Power of Evil is actually joining the PvP section of the game as well. So because he's done in bottom lane, he's now going to group up for this dragon, which makes sense. This these objectives, by the way, will not last long on this rift with how much DPS TSM are ready to dish out. But Golden Guardians going to have to be more concerned with the fact that they can't see and TSM are about to grab the Mountain Soul. They have to fight, but they don't want to. Oh, look at PoE. Just chilling in the brush, waiting. Nautilus ultimate stolen, that's a pretty good one. But Golden Guardians, there's no flank here. Oh. You have to go straight face first into TSM.
Yeah, and the longer they wait around, this Varus poke is adding up. Licorice is down to a third. Chime is down to a little over half. A couple more of these arrows and they're not even gonna have the opportunity to fight. And now Licorice is gonna have to go back to base and TP back in because he's so low. Golden Guardians have gotta pick their moment, but Power of Evil is marking AblazeOlive.
Yeah, Huni out there as well. Goes Golden. TSM though, are gonna just keep the rest of them out. AblazeOlive with a nice flash. As Iconic does also pop his stasis. And now they're in the dragon pit, like hoping to 50-50 it, I guess. But TSM are just going to fight them. Licorice going to go in now, try and make something happen. Big Haymaker with the face breaker. But the dragon goes over to Golden Guardians. Can they get out alive, though? As Gwen is looking to try and snip them all to bits. As Spica dominating, grabs himself a double. PoE will fall, but it's only Stixxay left in a 1v4. That is a BMT BF I've ever seen one. And Stixxay, the Q off the Varus load, thanks to Soroldis, is going to give TSM yet another ace, and very likely this game as well.
The world's shortest TP flank from Huni. He's setting records, and TSM are about to be knocking down bases, cleaning up Golden Guardians, and they've got the game.
Alfari chiming in right at the very end. Unfortunately, you will not get your wish this week, mate, but TSM are going to complete the early game stumbles and turn it into a very dominating victory at the end.
Yeah, really nicely done around that dragon there. Lost was just hitting so much poke, and it really did kind of force the hand here of Golden Guardians. Those Varus arrows coming through constantly, whittling them down. Licorice went back to base, TP'd back in. They're starting to get poked down again, so they were currently kind of forced to engage. PowerOfEvil did a good job actually marking the flank. You know, that's what he's doing over by that blue brush. Finds AblazeOlive on the flank. They're really kind of just eliminating a lot of the options, a lot of the windows that Golden Guardians would be trying to look for there. They had well-established battle lines. They played well from a disadvantage. They responded to some of the Golden Guardians' plays. I think there's stuff to review there for TSM as far as the early game goes, but you know, the mid game, the late game, their team fighting was far superior to Golden Guardians.
Yeah, I mean, look, we're getting Huni Nocturne almost every game, it feels like. Mm-hmm. We're basically getting control mage every game for PoE. I think it's pretty safe to say that the TSM style is well established. And even though we may ask for more diversity in the playstyles you're wanting to play, you cannot argue with TSM's record. And it looks very good with the style they're comfortable with. So another win there, even though Golden Guardians did give it a good go. With that, though, it is time for us to step away. But when we return, we are going to be hearing from